This is a very winnable seat, y'all. So I graduated next door from Etowah High School in Cherokee County. My husband graduated from Lassiter, and if he had lived 10 feet closer, he would have gone to high school with me instead of in Cobb County. And I'm thankful he didn't, because I don't think we would be married. He was not very cool in high school. I wasn't either, so those paths just wouldn't have crossed. My name is Nicole Horn, and I'm running for Labor Commissioner. And I always like to start off my speeches talking a little bit about growing up and my parents. So I grew up the child of a nurse, so my mom, like me, was a working parent all while I was growing up, and my dad was a lifetime union member. My dad was a heavy equipment operator, which is a fancy way of saying he built roads for a living. He loved his job. And my mom would take us out driving and she'd be like, "Feel this road? Your dad built this road." And I share this because until I was 16, so 30 years ago, I grew up in Connecticut. And my dad built roads in New York and Connecticut. And every year, usually right before Christmas, he was laid off from work because you can't build roads when it's snowy and icy out. And so my dad applies for unemployment benefits. And we were just talking about this. He was visiting me last week. He got those benefits within a week. Within a week, y'all. That's the way the system is supposed to work. And that is what the Department of Labor is in charge of, paying unemployment benefits. In Georgia, when this pandemic hit, and this is still happening now, this isn't something that's been resolved over 2 years, although the current labor commissioner has had 2 years to create a system that works. People are still waiting 4 to 6 months to receive their unemployment benefits. That means people are worried and scared if they can keep the roof over their head, put food on the table, have money to pay for their cars, to pay for their phones. I have talked to people. And when I'm out, so I'm spending a lot of time on the phone cold calling people who I don't know, asking them for money and for their votes, because that's what you do when you run. And people say, "Why do I care about the labor commissioner?" And I say, "You care because when it doesn't work, which is what's happened right now, we see a huge spike in evictions." And that's what Georgia is seeing right now, a huge spike in evictions. I have talked to people who have said to me, "I'm back at work, but because I didn't receive my unemployment benefits, I'm behind on my rent payment. So I am being evicted." The Department of Labor is in charge of paying unemployment benefits. That is our safety net. It is there when you need it most, when you lose a job through no fault of your own. And our Department of Labor failed. The current labor commissioner, he cut staffing in half between the end of the Great Recession and the start of the pandemic, cut staffing in half. That's why there was a story that came out recently that only 4% of calls are answered. 4%, y'all. That's because no one's there. We run on technology that's so old, it requires a mainframe. And I'm going to say what runs our unemployment system. And those of you who know what it is, you're going to show your age. It's run on COBOL. Yes, COBOL. For those of you who don't know what COBOL is, it's a really, really old programming language. It's pre-Java. They stopped teaching it in the 80s. Now, I'm not exaggerating. There you go. I'm not exaggerating. And what's crazy about this is that we received a federal grant to upgrade our technology in 2012. And Mark Butler chose not to use it. He also closed the 40-plus career centers that are designed to help people find jobs and to get their unemployment questions answered. Closed them. They are still all not open. The few that are open, they said, "We've only opened them to help you with jobs. We're not answering any questions about unemployment." It is ridiculous. And y'all, there's a reason why he's not running again. There's a reason. It's because there's no way in hell he could win. So my background, which you probably want to know, why on earth are you running for labor commissioner and why on earth would I vote for you? Well, I'm the most qualified candidate who's running. There's five Democrats who are running for labor commissioner. I owned a company for 15 years that actually worked with universities across the country, and we used labor data to help universities select and in many cases build programs for adult students. I have built bridges to jobs for adults. I have the programs that I have helped launch in Georgia have literally helped thousands of people transition into careers with living wages. I've done that. I'm also the only candidate who has worked within large organizations to improve processes. And y'all, that matters because the technology is broken, the staffing is crap, but it's also processes that are the problem. 80% of people who apply for unemployment were initially turned down. 80%. That's why we have this huge backlog of appeals. It was the same percentage of Georgians, white and black, who applied for unemployment benefits. Twice as many black Georgians were turned down. That is a broken process. I have fixed that. Fixed broken processes before. And I have also, I'm the only candidate who has helped large organizations implement new technology. I'm the only one. So I am ready to go in with a mantra of people, processes, technology to fix our unemployment department. We are going to start with streamlining the processes so they work. And move to having the people to support it and the technology. We need an upgrade, and we can get the upgrade from a federal grant. I don't have to go to the state legislature to ask for this. There's federal money available. But y'all, ideally, we have this fantastic unemployment system that no one uses. And here's why. This is what we are not talking about in Georgia. Underemployment. Underemployment is a problem in our state. And what underemployment is people working in jobs for which they are overqualified, or they're working at jobs that they can't get the number of hours they want. We're hearing of this great resignation and this huge demand for work. I'm talking to people who are looking for jobs and aren't able to get them. There is a disconnect. So what can the Department of Labor do? Well, this is why I'm a Democrat. I believe in government. Government should be there to strengthen community. We can do that through apprenticeship programs and internships. You've got in your backyard Lockheed. You've got Dobbins. You've got in your backyard the Home Depot. We won't talk about the crazy former CEO of Home Depot. Just let that go. You've got Napa Auto Parts. So you've got unions that have fantastic apprenticeship programs that I've gone and started to meet with them. I've seen the IBEW electricians program. I've seen the sheet metal workers. I've seen the iron workers. And when I say to them, how many people do you get from the Department of Labor into your apprenticeship program? Apprenticeship programs, keep in mind, these are earn while you learn jobs. So you're not paying money to learn. You are earning $15 an hour for most of the union apprenticeship programs when you start. Within a few years, you're making between $60,000 and $80,000. And they tell me nobody has been sent from the Department of Labor. So first, we can work with unions on existing apprenticeship programs. But I also, not everyone wants to do something in skilled labor, even though we have a huge demand for skilled labor and it's a great job. Some people want a white collar job. You know, I was talking with a VP of technology the other day from one of Cobb County's corporate headquarters, and he said that they are running an apprenticeship program where they're taking people off the floor of their store who are making $12 and $15 an hour and training them to be software engineers. Software engineers. From working on the floor of a store to a software engineer. We can do more of those programs. We need a vision for that, and you need somebody with the experience to build those. Our Department of Labor should also be the hub for paid internships. And I'm not talking about coffee and filing. I'm talking about projects, paid projects over a given period of time, term, so that it works with schools, so that our HBCUs, our public schools, our private schools, our tech schools can say, all right, we've got students to send to you, and our businesses know where to go to get interns. Some of my best employees started out as interns, paid interns, that we pulled up. It helps strengthen resumes. It helps us keep our talent here in Georgia. There's one other thing that we can do to help strengthen jobs in Georgia. There are 5 states right now that have what's called a self-employment assistance program. Mississippi is one of them, and it always makes me nervous when Mississippi is doing something better than us. This is a program where if you lose a job through no fault of your own and you qualify for unemployment, but you have an idea for a new business, you can receive your unemployment benefits for the given period of time while you work with the Small Business Administration and the Department of Labor to get your business launched. That's a fantastic way to start new businesses. 43% of Georgians work for a small business. Let's grow that. The last thing I want to talk about, and I could get in the weeds on other things too, so y'all, I didn't know this when I first started running. I met with someone from Women on the Rise, and she was telling me, Women on the Rise is an organization that helps women who are returning to their community from their prison sentence. And she said to me, she told me about the multiple times she's been in and out of the prison system. I won't get into the fact that as I was listening to her, me, middle-aged white lady, is like, yeah, you shouldn't have gone to prison for that. I wouldn't have gone to prison for that. Well, let's put that, it makes me furious, let's put that aside for a second. She said, I'm not going to prison this time. I said, why? She said, I have a job. I said, what do you mean? She's like, well, nobody helps anybody leaving prison get jobs. Y'all, Department of Labor should have a team working with our prison system to help people get jobs at their age. That's a way to really strengthen our communities. So that's my vision for a larger, more progressive Department of Labor. I'm also going to be setting up regional labor boards that work with, we have some great nonprofits in Georgia. We have some great nonprofits right here in your backyard.
Yes, we do.
Our board should have nonprofit leadership, union leadership, business leaders, and activists on it so that we are able to use all of our resources at each regional area. I will be putting in place investigative teams so we can look at wage theft, discrimination, misclassification, and unsafe work environments. It makes me crazy that we had deaths in Gainesville from a poultry plant that people said they knew was dangerous. They didn't have a place to call. So I will be setting up phone numbers and websites so we can report that. Georgia doesn't have an administrative arm so that when discrimination happens, something can be filed and lawsuits can be established. The Department of Labor, I will be establishing that administrative arm. So Department of Labor should be an advocate for workers. That's what I will make it. Anyway, I am so proud to be here. I am going to be the first woman elected to this position. Sorry, dads, but give this job to a working mom and you know it's going to get done. I've been endorsed by Georgia Winlist. I've been endorsed by several of our elected officials. I'm excited to hopefully get your vote and your support. If you want to, please donate. I, unlike our other representatives, I can take money and I need it. I'm one of 5 running in this primary, but I'm the most qualified. And y'all, I'm the one that will win the general election. And I need volunteers. So my website is Nicole Horn for Georgia, all spelled out, that, like that. if you want to volunteer, if you want to donate, if you just want to talk with me, please reach out. And can I take questions now, Matt? Am I allowed? All right, questions. Yes.
I have 2 questions.
Okay.
What about contract workers? And the other one is, what about the living wage?
Ah, great question. So I'm going to start with living wage. I'm not running on things that I can't change. So I believe we need to increase our minimum wage. I will be an advocate, I will be a voice, I will be out front talking about, if you want to end the Great Resignation, lift our minimum wage to $15 an hour, tie it to inflation so we don't have to have this fight anymore. I'm a believer in that, but I don't run on things that I don't think I can create. I think it's disingenuous. It's why there are other people running who have talked about growing the career centers to 80 career centers, and I'm like, I don't know if you've noticed this, but we have a Republican General Assembly and you're not gonna get that done. So that's why I'm running on mobile career centers. We will create a handful of mobile career centers so we can go where unemployment and underemployment is highest. When we get a Democratic General Assembly, yes, we will add career centers. But I don't run on things I don't think I can change. So contract workers, that's a great question. So, and I assume you're talking about misclassification and going after treating people as employees when they should be qualified as employees. Is that what you mean?
Yes.
Okay, all right. So that's what's called misclassification. So a 1099 worker is a contract worker. And there are really clear parameters for when you can treat someone as a contract worker. They have to bring their own equipment. They have to set their own hours. They have to use their own processes. There's like five things that you've got to do. Unfortunately, in many cases, and we are losing millions of tax dollars, a lot of companies try and skirt around this and treat and pay people as contract workers so they don't have to pay their federal and state unemployment and state taxes. So they just are getting around taxes. So a House bill passed that clarifies misclassification so we can go after it, and it should pass in the Senate. We have been working to pass this for years, and I've been talking to unions about this. Laws don't matter unless you enforce them. So when I talked about the investigative teams and the enforcement, that 1099 work and making sure that we are treating employees as an employee when it's appropriate is part of that, what that team will be investigating. So thank you so much for asking me that. Other questions? Y'all, thank you so much.